Boy. Good morning. What a place, huh? This is an amazing theater. Probably the nicest I've ever presented in. It's also an amazing town. My presentation and what I'm talking about is typically boring stuff, business. It's not exciting like technology. But technology makes business exciting in a way. And it does it because it changes very rapidly commerce. It changes how business is done and who wins and who loses. And this is what this story is going to be about. It's going to be the story of one industry that I was a member of for 8 years, mobile phone industry. And now I'm also still a member in a way of being a commentator and a chronicler of it. But before we dive into some of the details of this story, I wanted to think of a metaphor. How do you describe commerce in general? Because a lot of things we think about in terms of business are very new concepts. They're not necessarily things that we as human beings have done for a long time. Commerce is only a few hundred years old as a human institution or a civilization. And before then, there were still many competitions. In fact, warfare is the oldest, probably, competition out there. So I was thinking of a metaphor for commerce and for business competition, and I thought, okay, how do we think about it in terms of warfare? And often the idea is that, you know, you have big battles between two opposing groups that are very evenly matched. If one is smaller than the other, it tends to run away. There's no point to fighting. But sometimes you end up in fights like this. This is if you don't recognize this, this is a picture painted of the charge of the Light Brigade in the Crimean War, 1840s or so. And the quote is coming from an observer, a general, French observer, who said, "C'est magnifique, mais c'est pas la guerre," meaning, you know, this was very heroic, this was very spectacular, this was very romantic in a way, but this is no way to fight. So, if this isn't a way to fight, this isn't competition, proper competition, what is? And so the alternative view is something from an even older epoch. This is from the Bible. 3,000 years ago is telling the story of David and Goliath. And here we had also a battle, and they decided to settle it on the basis of one-on-one competition between champions from either side. And the idea was that there was one giant champion on the side of the Philistines, and David opposed him. He was the only one who would volunteer. And this is a very common story. We have this sort of as a metaphor of the winner being the disadvantaged, the smaller player, somehow successful against a much more powerful player. And I think this is much more common metaphor of what actually happens in business. All the great success stories begin like this, not like the battle in the Crimean War. This is very much the story of every large company today, including our sponsors. They all came from being Davids and beating a Goliath. And this happens rather quickly. That, as I said in the beginning, technology allows these battles to be fought very quickly. And I'm going to illustrate now this particular battle that we've witnessed. And this is something, again, I was present as a witness and a participant from throughout this, most of this time frame, but much even earlier than this. And what I'm showing now is a volume chart showing on this axis here. I hope you can see this. This is volumes of mobile phones shipped in the one quarter. And here we have, of course, the major mobile phone vendors. These were the big names, and keep an eye on the date. This is 2007. This is just 5 years ago, almost to the day. And what happened was that, of course, we had Nokia number one, and Motorola number two, and Samsung number three, and then Sony, Ericsson, and LG. And this is, again, units shipped. So I'm going to use a slider tool here to actually show you what was happening. So by December, let's go forward a bit, December here, you see how Nokia became. It's actually shipping now at a rate of about 140 million phones per quarter. Samsung has temporarily, perhaps, we don't know, but Motorola is neck and neck. And now we have two entrants coming in, two Davids, Apple, HTC, and RIM is also, has been for a while, but they're slowly growing here. So this is the volumes that we were able to see from Apple and HTC in December 2007, which was only about 6 months after the launch of the iPhone. Now, keep an eye, I'm going to fast forward a little bit here, and you can see how by 2010, for example, the situation changed. So I'm going to go to the December quarter as well. Here we go. So Apple now is reaching 15 million or so. HTC is about half of that. Motorola has collapsed. You can see the problem Motorola has, especially vis-a-vis the number one Nokia. But Samsung has also grown tremendously. And RIM, of course, has grown, but it isn't keeping up quite as much. It's already been overtaken by Apple. And then, again, LG and Sony Ericsson a little bit slowing down. But if we fast forward again to the present, which is period ending March, first quarter of 2012, here we have Samsung has overtaken. This has been a big bombshell. First time in 14 years that Nokia is not number one. But Samsung is here, Nokia is here, but look at Apple. It's almost 40 million. In fact, it was, I think, 31 million, a little bit more in the December quarter, but it actually didn't drop very much, which was surprising to some, but not all. LG and Motorola very much actually under pressure, and HTC somehow also starting to slow down. Now, this is only showing you volumes. I'm going to play the same story now with revenues. And revenues, I'm going to actually let it run by itself so I don't have to push the slider. But you can see, in this case, the story begins the same way. Projector problem here. It begins the same way with Nokia, Motorola, and Samsung, more or less the five major players. So let's push play now. And you can see now there's a bit of cyclicality due to seasons, but pretty much Apple's revenues begin. Now you see the date, 2010, towards the end of 2010. Okay, Apple is already overtaken Nokia. It's overtaken also Samsung periodically now, December. And it's, here we are today, where Apple is nearly $24 billion, Samsung is about $17 billion in revenue, and Nokia has fallen to third place. RIM actually still in the game, but nowhere near the other majors. So this is the story, therefore, of revenues. This is the second indicator of success in the market. Units obviously tells you something about market share, revenue share, where is the money going, how many dollars are they capturing. The final way, though, to look at it is in terms of profits. And these are what are called operating profits. It's before taxes and before other this allows you to compare companies on an equal basis. Here, again, we have the same situation. Nokia, Motorola is losing money in 2007, but Samsung was quite a bit lower than Nokia. And again, Apple didn't have any business at the time. So if I play this story now, same thing essentially to revenues, very similar story here, but notice Apple already now in 2008, it's actually, it's a bit of lag here, but already taking over in 2010, and then growing and growing and growing, and this is the situation now. So it's an amazing story to me to show how this one small company was able to capture such a lion's share of profit. And this is, after all, the bottom line, profitability. And just to give you an idea and just one glance of what you just saw, this is the same story here. I'm going to put up volumes. This is a picture which shows exactly the market shares as a stacked area. So in March, Nokia had 44%. I don't know how many of you can see this, but you have here the figure. And as I drag my finger, you can actually see the numbers changing. So in the device space, you still have sort of a split between Nokia and Samsung at about 70%. But in terms of looking at revenues, the picture changes more dramatically, where an entrant at the very bottom, Apple, now has 41%. And we're going to change now to profit picture. And here, it's a very, very different story. Well, we had essentially this area here, which is what Nokia is, going to zero. And this area here, which is Apple, going to 73%. So this is what we call a disruption. This is when an entrant is able to not only take almost all the profits from the incumbents, but is actually able to grow the whole pie much bigger. As you saw, the size of the Apple bar was much bigger than the Nokia bar ever was. So there's actually a creation of new profits, a vast pool of new profits has been created and captured. And this is because, again, this is, disruption isn't about a zero-sum game. It's the taking of value from incumbents, but it's also the creation of new value, because they're actually enabling more people to consume a resource or a service. And just to illustrate one more aspect of disruption, and that is that it is unforeseen. Yes.
We go to the second line because there's a distortion.
Okay.
Yeah?
All right.
We wait for a few minutes.
I'll talk through that. Yeah, no problem. So what is interesting about disruptions is that they're not foreseeable, meaning that nobody inside the business or in the industry, in the incumbents, is able to see this happening to them. They are unable to predict that someone smaller will beat them. Those who beat them cannot even predict that they will succeed. And all external observers to the industry, whether they are industry analysts, Wall Street analysts, or even laymen, don't expect this to happen. It's an unbelievable story. No one would have expected David to beat Goliath. Certainly not Goliath himself. Certainly not his peers. But not even his own friends. And maybe not even himself. So to prove that this is actually, I mean, we all think about these things, oh, it was a surprise, but some will say, well, I remember what was happening, I believe that they would win. But we can actually get data to prove sentiment, or what was the sentiment. And the data I collected, for example, is forecasts from analysts. These are people who are in the business. Okay, thanks. These are people who are in the business of predicting things, or at least trying to make their reputations on their ability to predict things. And I have here a few names of analysts who were predicting the Apple's performance as a proxy. And you see here, yellow are Wall Street analysts, and green are so-called amateurs or blogger analysts. And in 2008, that what we are measuring is error, EPS error, is how closely we're able to predict Apple's performance. Now, since EPS error, EPS for Apple is very much dependent on the iPhone, this is a good proxy of predicting the whole business of mobile. So what was happening is here is you have an error rate for that particular quarter. Down below zero means you missed by guessing too low, and above zero you missed by guessing too high. And obviously 10% is well, you might say it's significant, but it's not uncommon. But let's see what happens if we jump around a little bit. Again, I'm going to pick some random quarters, and you see a similar pattern where you have many professionals predicting Apple being off by 20% now, even 30%. when we have a few amateurs being a much more accurate, almost getting exactly right the figures. Again, this is 2009, and the pattern doesn't really change no matter which I pick. This is going to be completely random here. But here you see, for example, in one quarter, in the September quarter 2009, which I think was an iPhone launch quarter, you know, we see that indeed everybody was under expecting things, and some of these are actually down again almost to 30%. And even some of the amateurs. Let's go forward a little bit. Now you see what's interesting is now we have more and more people predicting. This is a huge number of analysts now weighing in on the subject because it's a very hot topic, but you still see a very, very big error rate on average for the analysts, and a few predicting a little bit higher than what actually happened. So I'm just going to jump to again the latest quarter. We had a little bit of excess optimism here, but still, after 5 years, analysts are not expecting Apple to perform as well as it has been performing. It's actually reaching the same maximum error and probably the same median error. How can you do that? How can you guess every quarter wrong like this on such a great scale? I'm not going to talk about the motivations of this group of people, but the fact is that you cannot ignore the pattern, a consistent pattern of under expectations on Apple. In fact, what would be nice is if I could show you this exact pattern for the incumbents, and you will see actually the exact opposite, over expectation every quarter. I did this actually for RIM, because RIM was, it's not as good a story because for many years it was actually very well performing and it only turned down recently. But the point is that analysts whose job it is to think about this every day aren't able to foresee what's happening. So this is another characteristic. A small guy wins, a big guy loses. The small guy creates more value than ever existed before, and no one is able to predict that it'll happen. No one is able to actually believe it even after it happens. And I needn't mention it to this audience. This is just a graph to prove why this was happening was because of the iPhone and essentially the profitability in the industry. I'm only showing here, for example, profit versus smartphones. This is kind of like what is the cause of this disturbance. Obviously, since Apple only sells smartphones, it's obvious that, but it just shows also the same picture where over time, I'm going to try to just play this, you'll see how the correlation is direct between how many smartphones you sell and how profitable you are. The size of the bubble is the price of the products in average selling price. And you see very small, Nokia was actually doing quite well in smartphones with Symbian, but this is the situation today where we have high price products, high volumes of smartphones, and of course the most profitable businesses. And these are almost at zero in profit and very low smartphones. So there's a very direct correlation. But again, this is pretty obvious to anyone here that smartphones are the cause of this disruption. Smartphones were somehow asymmetric. They came into this business with Apple and with RIM and with HTC, and essentially they changed people's perceptions of what a phone should be. And there are many people who have studied the sort of psychological issues around smartphone use. How do people actually use these things, monitoring their behavior? Did they really begin to use browsing? Browsing was done before on a device or a computer, but now it's moving to mobile. But essentially, what these are is little computers. It's not appropriate to say that they are multimedia products or that they are business products or that they are gaming products. They're all of those things, general purpose computer products, which is what the PC came to be, and now the iPad as well. Basically, it's what happened is that whoever was focused on the job of serving a computing solution to users won, and whoever was serving a communications only problem lost. And the communications problem was the foundation of the telecom business. It was actually connecting people, as Nokia would say. This is their business. And now the business or the job to be done is not connecting people, it's connecting people to data, which happens to also be connecting people eventually through other means. But the data aspect of it turned out to be somehow asymmetric, even though everybody expected it. Everybody saw this coming, even as early as 1990s. right? We had Microsoft entering the mobile operating system game with Windows CE in 1998, initially for PDAs. They then introduced in early 2000s the Pocket PC brand. Pocket PC, right? Make sense even back then. And then they had the Windows Mobile brand. Palm had its operating system available for licensing. Samsung had products available, Windows, Symbian, as well as Linux. All of these were available for a decade. And I was working, in fact, in the group inside Nokia called Mobile Software as early as 2003. So clearly, this isn't that someone suddenly woke up and said the future is data. But the problem was they weren't able to emphasize the data aspects of this product. They weren't able to build the entire business model of the company around data. Now, what means in practice is that you don't go and say to people, here's my new phone. You would launch, your key launch event would be, here's my new API. Here's the developer event I'm going to have to showcase my product. And I'm going to actually attach brand value to the platform itself. That did not happen with either Symbian or with Palm or with Windows Mobile. They were all essentially subsumed as brands to the overall device brand. Nokia would still launch Nokia phones with a number associated with the model and the product name, and that was something they remained consistent with even to today. So clearly something, the game did change. It changed from a device business to a software business, specifically to a software platforms business, to a software development as sort of the APIs that allow apps to sit on top of the device to create value and create an ecosystem where billions and billions of apps would be downloaded within a matter of a few years. An industry, the app industry, is now, at least from Apple's reporting, we don't have all the data, but Apple reported over 25 billion downloads. $4 billion were paid to developers since the inception of the App Store, which was in 2008, even less time than this charts show. And now we just heard from Rovio that they had 1 billion downloads, and they are going public. Rovio, the maker of the Angry Birds game, also from Finland. Rovio is actually going to IPO. We now know some of the financial details, and they are becoming a franchise that may, in fact, overtake Nokia in market value. And it was an unbelievable, I actually tweeted about it about a year ago. I said, I think Rovio someday will be worth more than Nokia. And now I was again pushing my neck out saying it, but now it's going to be, it's a fait accompli, it's a done deal. So the question I have then is to sort of wrap up and have you think a bit further is, did these incumbents who got disrupted understand what happened? I mean, to us it seems obvious, given the data, that it did change. And then we even can make a simple leap in logic and say what the cause is. But have they changed? Have they understood what's happening here? And you could ask the same question of the Goliath versus David story is, did the Philistines who were representing, or who Goliath represented, did they understand that warfare changed because you have projectiles? Did they actually change the way they fought? Did they change their core values as a result of this? We don't know the answer exactly, but probably not. But we can actually get some data for the incumbents here. So did Nokia recognize? What happened in the last CES, which was just in January, is 3GSM, which is in February, they launched a new product. It was actually a very proud moment for them, and they got a lot of recognition for it. It was a 41 megapixel camera. I found that to become somewhat perplexing. Of course, Lumia launched at CES, and Lumia is a sort of a brand that speaks of a platform. It speaks of Windows Phone, and I think that's a great product, and it's going to in the right direction. But fundamentally, that didn't change what Nokia is at its core. It's still a hardware company. And they've been developing technology to allow very high-quality cameras in their phones, which have not just high resolution, but also the ability to retell stories with pictures. This is great technology. However, they didn't launch a new API. They didn't launch as a platform business. those are still using Symbian. And so the emphasis, at least in the front, front of the brand, is still about hardware. And that's Nokia. What about Samsung that's successful? As we saw, it's number two now in profits, number one in volumes. But did they recognize that the game has changed? They were a hardware company, they are a hardware company, they are components makers as well. But if you listen to their messages today, they are not talking about APIs, they're not talking about developer events. Where is the Samsung Worldwide Developer Conference? Is there such a thing? Are we having it sell out within a matter of hours? Google has such an event, Microsoft has such an event, Apple has such an event. Why doesn't Samsung have such an event? Where is their core platform? They have a core platform in the form of Bada, actually, which is their own creation or their own adaptation of software. But that isn't what is being promoted. The greatest launch event for Samsung this year has been the Galaxy S3. Wonderful piece of kit. It's not a platform, though, is it? And so I leave that open question out there. We can get, perhaps, in Q&A a little bit deeper into that. But I want to leave you also with one more thing, is like, you are entrepreneurs, we all are today. And you have to think about, how can I be disruptive? How can I succeed in my market, no matter how big it is? So I want to, okay, this actually slide isn't here. But there are several key phrases that I want to leave you with, which I think I mentioned in passing sort of throughout this process. Number one, asymmetric competition. Try to figure out a way that you can win the battle because your competitor will not respond. There will not be a retaliation of your entry, that you are going to actually be welcomed as a competitor. That is a very tough thing to do. In fact, it's funny because when you see the messages that the incumbents issue when an entrant comes in that's asymmetric, they say things like, we welcome competition. We wish them luck. And many times they don't respond in kind. This is what happened again with the iPhone. They said, well, we are in a different business. In fact, at Nokia at the time, there was a division called multimedia phones, which had also large screens and who were designed to consume media. And the iPhone was considered to be a competing product against multimedia or the N-series product. But it was not seen as competitive with E-series products, which were enterprise, or C-series, which were general consumer products, even as smartphones. And not to mention, of course, that they weren't seen anywhere near touching the low-end sort of just Series 40, which were not true operating system or true smartphones. So Nokia saw the iPhone as potentially even overlapping a tiny, tiny piece of their total business. But of course, it came in and it absorbed users from all of those sectors. And most of the people who bought an iPhone actually gave up a Razr. It was the number one abandoned phone in the first generation or even the second generation iPhone. It was people moving from a non-smartphone to a smartphone. And you see that actually, by the way, the symmetry of competition is that now when Nokia enters or even RIM enters the market with a competing product, they're going to somehow kill Apple and kill the iPhone. You hear this all the time. Why not hear the message that this new product from Nokia is actually not a threat at all to Apple? This should be completely seen by Apple as irrelevant. But no, they're going for head-to-head. They're doing the charge of the light brigade. They're doing frontal assault. And this is why I don't get excited. I think they'll do fine, perhaps gain some market share. But there isn't this sort of thing, aha, this is disruptive. They're going to be seen by Apple as a joke, and they're not going to be responding to the threat properly. If anything, it's potentially that Google with Android is doing it. But they're not a hardware company, and they're not capturing nearly the same profits or targeting the same goals. We can talk a bit about that, if you'd like, in the Q&A. So asymmetric competition. The other thing is the discovery of these businesses that Apple didn't enter by saying, okay, I'm going to take over the phone business. They said, we want to create mobile computing. We want to create a way for you to enable a Mac-like or, let's say, PC-like experience on your device. And they said, look, browsing sucks. email sucks, all of these issues with the user experience, and because you have a lousy input method, we're going to add a new input method, which is actually not something we invented, but it's a finger touch, no stylus, no keypad, no keyboard, nothing like that. And that was their approach, is that they looked at the problem and said, okay, this is an unsolved need, and I think the job to be done is user experience, the job to be done is input method, we're going to tackle that problem, not trying to solve how do we sell it. That was not the problem. How do we find operator partners? 90% of the time, even more, I would say, of the executive time spent by the incumbent is to figure out how to approach the market, how to deal with go-to-market issues, how to get operator support, how to get distributor, how to get channel, how to deal with pricing issues, how to deal with regional issues. These are very common questions, and if you ever try to pull an executive aside and ask them, well, what are you doing about innovation? What are you doing about really changing the game? They said, talk to me about that later. So these are very important things. I think actually entrepreneurs and smaller players have an advantage because they don't have markets to maintain. They don't have distribution networks. They don't have to deal with these questions that these executives are spending their whole time on. So certainly Apple didn't have to deal with how do I support 500 operators and all of the politics involved with that. They only had one operator to launch with, and that was a pretty desperate operator at the time. AT&T was not even, was barely functioning as a business. So these are the things I want to leave you with, is the idea of asymmetric competition, finding new jobs to be done because you're studying the needs of the user, not the needs of the market. And segment your market accordingly, segment according to the jobs that you need to do, solve these little puzzles that you have to solve, rather than trying to understand whether someone is an executive customer or someone is a consumer or an expressive or psychological profiled in a certain way. That's really the story I've witnessed. I think, in fact, if you follow the discussion on my website, you'll see examples there of all industries where this disruption has happened. Mostly I focus on technology, but you can go back and see the history of the PC industry and how it disrupted the mainframe and the business of mini computers, the IBMs and the digital equipment, all that happened within my lifetime, maybe not yours. But these things are historic facts, and also the research that's gone on before me has been all in what happened in the 50s and 60s on automobiles and all the other industries. Technology always played a part, but it really caused new entrants to take the business away from old incumbents. And it's the same story, David versus Goliath, and David always wins. Thank you, and I'd like to take some time for questions.
Yes. I would be interested to hear your theory about future new input methods. Because changing of input methods tend to signify great shifts.
Yes, I wrote this myself once, that if you go back and listen to the original launch of the iPhone that Steve Jobs showed, that he was proud of having lived through three eras of computing, all of which were predicated by the change in an input method. First, it was the mouse and the Macintosh, which brought us the windowing metaphor for user experiences. Then it was the scroll wheel, which allowed the device to really use a lot of media. And then thirdly, it was, for him, the finger touch input, which was he was launching at the time. And he thought that that would create a whole new industry and a whole new platform and a whole new set of experiences, which it did, as we know from the apps universe. So the question is there something else? And I try to also measure how long it took between these input method explosions, these disruptive sparks. And my impression was that these times were shrinking, so that it took maybe 15 years between the mouse and the scroll wheel, and now less than that to go, 10 years to go to the touch, and now from touch do we have 5 years to look forward to the next one, which is now, actually, it would be now. And indeed, we had a hint of it, we had a voice, we had Siri coming out. I think it's, Siri is still very experimental, and we're not sure how that's going to play out in the mass market, but it could be very disruptive. And the way you would think about it is this, is say, if Siri became good enough, and it isn't, it's actually very bad, and people can curse it as much as they want, but it has a tendency to get better. And so what happens is, how good could it possibly get if you could interact with the device entirely through voice? Then you actually would not need a screen at all. So think about it, where the, you know, if you think about the performance trajectories, like getting better and better, and so the screens are the things that have gotten better and better when we had touch. Touch allowed, of course, so either you make the screen bigger or you make the screen more high resolution, and both were done, one by Apple and one by Samsung. Samsung keeps stretching the screens, perhaps adding a new technology, OLED, better readability under certain conditions. So everybody's focused on the question of visibility, but a true disruptor would come to this problem and say, what if we don't have a screen at all? And then let's build a platform on that. What would it look like? Then you only have a microphone, a Bluetooth headset, or something like that, and that's all you need to do to interact with a phone. Again, it would be much worse. Nobody will say that's a good browsing experience. But that's not what you're going to hire the device to do. You're going to hire it to solve your problem. And you, many people have deep, deep problems. I want to do, get this done in my life. I want to be loved. I want to be feel safe. These are very core basic problems. And if you solve that problem, I want to lose weight, for example. What if it just nags you all day long and says, don't eat? Or it observes what you're eating and suddenly tells you, you know what, don't touch that chocolate. That would be a wonderful thing, because you would hire someone, a person, to do that, and you would pay a lot of money for that person, because if they said, if I lose weight, you know, I'm sexy, and that's important to me. So, you see what I mean? This is how an innovator would come, should come to this equation, and someone like, I would, you know, maybe it's Nokia, maybe it's going to be someone else. They have laboratories to work on these things. Maybe it's a startup, maybe it's someone we've never heard of before, but they're going to focus on that problem. I mean, in some way, Instagram was such a thing because it solved a deeper need, it was acquired, and perhaps they should have stayed on the trajectory. Perhaps Instagram someday could have grown into being the next Nokia. We just don't know now, but that's the way it happens. Thanks, good question. Any others? How about over there?
Yes, hello. I was just wondering if you could speak to the carrier role as well. I mean, I think you've seen the AT&T quote saying that one of the things they regretted was unlimited data, but that was probably a key ingredient of that early acceleration for Apple. But it seems in the US at least that some carriers are sort of wanting to stick the genie back in the bottle and take away one of those key ingredients. And so what role do you think carriers play in sort of the disruptive angle of the industry?
There's so many pieces to an industry puzzle. So one thing, even you, let me answer it first of all by thinking in the PC world, back in the day when the PC disruption happened, yes, we know, and we celebrate Microsoft for what they did and to bring computing to the masses. But there are so many other people in that universe who enabled that. They enabled it because they maybe were making components. What about the poor hard drive maker? What about the ISPs? What about the service provision? What about the service VARs and all these other people who were involved? I see the operators, which are, by the way, combined a $1 trillion business, is much, much bigger than the hardware business, okay, much, much bigger in terms of the revenue capture. But they aren't an innovation engine. They are there because, of course, they're improving their networks all the time, but they're not redefining what a network is. In network businesses in general, it's like in the, if you talk about the car business and you always are thinking, well, this is a great new model, or I think they're innovating on the new power plant, the new technology for energy use, right, clean energy. But nobody thinks about the road network. Nobody says, well, the road network needs to be revolutionized. We think of it as something fixed that cannot change because it's so deeply embedded in our infrastructure. And yes, they always get better, and they in fact cost a lot of money to get better and to stay even up to speed. But that to me is not the game, the way it's played. Operators will talk about these things, but the problem is that, as Andy Rubin says, this is all this political discussion. whether they make a decision to carry one operating system or not, they are somehow trying to be makers of the market and trying to be decision makers about platforms and innovations. But markets, as powerful as operators are, markets are much more powerful. Markets meaning the buyers of everything, everybody, all the consumers, they will eventually vote, and they will vote for the winner in that sense. So I think the operators will be a powerful force, stakeholder, but they're not going to make the decisions about who really wins and loses. Yes, we had one more there.
I was just looking at the figures with the Nokia and the volumes that they were selling. And that was, I guess, that's worldwide sales, isn't it?
Yes, all my data is, I present is worldwide. I never, if I do something regional, I'll say it.
Because, I mean, I'm sort of looking at more regional stuff, more UK-based or stuff. So does it look dramatically different in sort of the US and the UK, so where Nokia doesn't ship as many handsets? Because looking at that, it still looks like Nokia is quite a big player in the number of handsets sold.
In the total pictures. Sure. In fact, you probably go to India and Nokia is still one of the biggest there, if not the biggest. At one time, Nokia had 70% market share in India. They also had some tremendous market share in China, but that's actually very rapidly declined in the last few quarters. If you go player by player, I'm not just going to mention not just Nokia, for example, but if you take RIM is still growing, actually, in the certain regions like the Middle East and certainly growing in Latin America. RIM has become actually a natural evolution for someone who has a low-end voice-only product. Their first smartphone is a BlackBerry because it allows them to do messaging, which is a killer app for them because it's actually something they pay much less using a BlackBerry than they would with SMS. So it's faster, it's more convenient, and it's cheaper. So all of those things are wonderful things for the brand. But you're right, it's a question that you have this issue globally that some markets move at different speeds. You also have, as I mentioned, because of the operator issues, you have politics. One of the political issues is that actually operators will act in concert with government sometimes to block an entrant. So they will, for example, in Japan, Docomo does not carry the iPhone. In China, China Mobile doesn't carry the iPhone. Sometimes they'll actually impose draconian self network technologies which are actually homegrown. It's a form of industrial policy to try to, you know, change what the dynamics are globally. But again, in the end, they all tend to shift away from that. It's only a temporary situation. So the problem is that you can be blinded by the local issue. You can see the issue locally and yet not see the big picture. And that will, again, the salesperson, the executive in charge of that group will say, look, I'm delivering profits today. You can't change this strategy. To do so would be destroying value. And they're right. The right strategy many times is to destroy value. And this is why it's so hard to do. Because destroying it now is better than waiting for you to be destroyed later. And okay, you know, there are many, many times people repeat this story, you know. But it's amazing how it really happens. Any other questions? Oh, we have a follow-up? Okay. Thing over here.
Simple question, but I think one that all of us keeps pondering, how many dominant platforms can there be in the end, in 3 years, in 5 years?
You know, this is a very good question, because if you go back and you listen to a lot of the commentary about Android, for example, the assumption is that because it has a viral potential, it does actually grow very quickly. And it grows very quickly because, number one, it's free. Number two, it actually has revenue share. So if you're a partner with Google, they'll actually give you a percentage of the revenues they get from search, which is amazing. It's like you start to own a bit of Google. I mean, that's a kind of thing that no OEM can resist and no operator can resist. But these aren't big numbers yet. So the challenge there is that, okay, some people would analyze that and say, okay, then Google will be dominant, and then it'll be the same game as we saw with the PC, where we had Microsoft reaching some 95% or more market share. The trouble with that thinking, though, is that again we have a much bigger and much more diverse market. A lot of the historical facts that made possible a what I call a monoculture of the computing, which was what was Windows. The monoculture grew because there were many constraints, costs primarily, the early adoption by businesses, not by consumers. Therefore, you have a very concentrated decision-making process where basically, you know, a room full like this of IT managers could have decided the future of the whole industry in about 1995 if they all agreed to buy Windows, because that they controlled, each one would control 50,000 seats. And so you would have this amplification factor of few decision makers. When every single consumer has a decision, you have much more potential for diversity and biodiversity in that sense. So we don't know, because we haven't seen any platform game played over 1 billion users. We have now 5 billion, actually 6 billion mobile connections in the world. That doesn't mean 6 billion consumers or decision makers, but we have certainly that many connections that have to be switched into some form of intelligent terminal. So that number is simply staggering. There's not been any technology, not even television, not automobiles, not refrigerators, that has reached that level of penetration. And I believe because of the simple scale of this and the localization of a lot of these political issues, that we'll still have multiple platforms. In many ways, also as developers, it's cheaper now to actually support more than one. It was impossible in the 1990s to commit your career to supporting two platforms. It was so hard, so expensive to write software that you could only do one, right? So no one would bother with a Macintosh. Even a giant company like Adobe would abandon the Macintosh because it didn't have enough market share. Now, however, I think even small developers can say, well, okay, I think I can handle two platforms. And then those two you choose might be different than the two another person would support. So I've actually maintained for over a year that there's actually potentially even five platforms available, though I think many of them will be flavors of one of them. So for example, we're seeing that Android is split into two, at least now. It may split again. And so what we'll see is like three or four flavors of Android, and then we'll see one or two more flavors like Windows Phone and iOS. But you also can think of it another way, is what is the critical mass that any platform can obtain to remain in the game, to remain relevant. And the story with iOS is that it's gotten to about 350 million now. And Android probably is over that quite a bit already, maybe half a billion. And if you draw the charts to see the growth, you'll say, okay, I think they're both on the trajectory to reach a billion users. So how can someone say if iOS reaches a billion users that this is a dead platform? A billion users will clearly self-sustain. It reaches the critical mass. And again, that's what Microsoft is fighting. They want to stay in the game and reach a minimum critical mass. And I think it may be as low as 200 million. If you get 200 million, you're going to be around for a while. And there's room enough for 200 million and 6 billion for a lot of people. So I'm confident that we'll see this multi-platform. It doesn't mean that everybody has to support every platform, but there's enough opportunity for everyone.
Unfortunately, we don't have any time for any more questions.
Okay.
But please give them a warm hand. Thank you very much.